Well, it's great to be with you, and my favorite topic of all time is studying and reading God's Word, and you have gotten a lot of meat already this morning. Wayne has talked about biblical theology, the foundation, really, of systematic theology, biblical theology, understanding each individual author in their particular time and place, following their key biblical themes. Then John gave you just an incredible lecture on cultural background, how we really need to read and understand God's Word through the eyes of the culture in which it was given. And really, the two things that hold those lectures so closely together is the question of context, right? There's the key to biblical interpretation, context. How do we understand a message given in a different context than ours, a different time, a different place? God's Word was given in a different world. And so that's what I want to piggyback on, that idea, and focus especially on principles. How do we read Scripture and apply Scripture in particular in a context so distant from the one in which it was given? We all start with the same basic foundation, though, don't we? At least hopefully in this room we do, and that is the authority of Scripture. Here's the great passage, the great key text on the authority of Scripture, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. All Scripture is God-breathed, is inspired by God, is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So all Scripture is inspired by God. All Scripture is useful. How much of Scripture is inspired? All of it. How much of Scripture is useful? Absolutely all of it is inspired. All of it is useful. But how is it useful? How do we use it? How do we hear God speak to us in literature written so long ago? The Bible can be read in many different ways and has been throughout history. It's been a weapon used for controlling others, for manipulation. There was a movie in 2010. I don't know if you saw the movie. I'm not sure I would recommend the movie, but it's called The Book of Eli. Denzel Washington is a character named Eli, and he has the last copy of the Bible in a post-apocalyptic world. His mission is to get it to a safe haven where it can be copied. This book with the ultimate answers, where it can be passed down for future generations. His nemesis, though, is a guy named Carnegie. Carnegie wants that book. He wants that Bible because he knows with that Bible he can control people. He can manipulate people. He can make them do what he wants them to do. That movie is a fascinating allegory on the potential of good or evil. And the Bible has been used throughout history for both great good but also great evil. A tool of promoting individuals, a tool of manipulating others. So it's not quite as simple as sometimes we make it. Sometimes we try to make the reading and application of the Bible as simple as God said it, I believe it, that settles it. I'm going to start with some myths related to the Bible. Do we obey, first of all the commands of Scripture? Should we obey all the commands of Scripture? Are you guys a bunch of liberals? Right? Should we obey all the commands of Scripture? Not so sure right now. Do we obey all the commands? Here's a command of Scripture. This is what you are to offer on the altar regularly each day. Two lambs a year old. Each day. How many of you offered your lambs this morning? In direct disobedience to Scripture. Do not plant your field with two kinds of seed. Do not wear clothing woven of two kinds of material. Anyone wearing cotton polyester blend today? We're going to stone you if you are. Just to warn you about that. Of all the creatures living in the water and the seas and streams, you may eat any that have fins and scales. But all creatures in the seas or streams that do not have fins or scales, you are to detest. That includes shellfish. It includes scallops, one of my favorite foods. Do you like scallops? I like them especially wrapped in bacon. That's a double whammy. That's a double unclean right there, right? You're going to drop dead if you eat that. Okay. We don't obey that command. Here's one. Give beer to those who are perishing. I knew I'd get an amen from this crowd right there. Wine to those who are in anguish. Let them drink and forget their poverty and remember their misery no more. That's not a good counseling verse, right? By the way, my wife is a marriage and family therapist. She doesn't use that verse. She doesn't say, here, let me give you a verse to respond to, okay? Do not cut your bodies for the dead or put tattoo marks on yourselves. Going to be a body check afterwards here. I am the Lord. If a man has a stubborn and rebellious son, then all the men of his town shall stone him to death. You must purge the evil from among you. We'd have a lot less juvenile delinquency if we followed this one, wouldn't we? How about this one? One of the Ten Commandments. For 6 days work is to be done, but the seventh shall be your holy day, a Sabbath of rest to the Lord. Whoever does any work on it must be put to death. It's good that you're here and not home cutting your grass, because we'd have to put you to death if you cut. Today's the Sabbath, right? Saturday is the Sabbath. Okay, you might say, well, that's the old covenant. We're not under the old covenant. We're under the new covenant. So should we obey all new covenant commands? You don't trust any of us anymore, do you? Yeah. What about New Testament commands? Here's one. Greet one another with a kiss of love. I didn't see any of you kissing each other when you came in. You're all living in disobedience to God's word on that one. Go sell everything you have. Give to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. Follow me, right? Give to the poor. Are we to sell everything we have? No longer drink water exclusively, but use a little wine for the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments. That's a command in Greek, an imperative in Greek, to drink a little wine now and then. Right? But every woman that has her head uncovered while praying or prophesying disgraces her head. If you pray or prophesy with your head uncovered, women, you are disgracing your head. Does not the very nature of things teach that if a man has long hair, it is a disgrace to him? That's below the ears, by the way, the official biblical category of long hair. No, I'm just kidding. Are you married? Do not seek a divorce. Okay, got that one. Are you unmarried? Do not look for a wife. No match.com, right? No christianmingle.com. Do not look for a wife. Okay, so we can see we don't obey all the commands of Scripture. So how do we discern which commands to obey and which we can safely ignore? How much of Scripture is inspired? How much of Scripture is useful? All of it, right? So how do we apply these commands? Here's some questions I want to deal with. What does it mean that the Bible is God's Word? There's the first question. What does it mean that the Bible is God's Word? Should we interpret the Bible literally? John was talking about that earlier. What does literally mean? I think we need to throw that term out completely because it's so misunderstood. We need to understand the Bible in its context. Not literally, in its cultural context, what the author intended it to mean. Should we obey everything the Bible commands? If not, how do we discern which biblical commands are so-called cultural and which are for God's people for all time? Now, if you think about it, all commands are cultural. All commands are given in a particular culture, a particular place, a particular time. But then how do we discern how we apply those commands in a different time and place? Ultimately, how do we read the Bible in changing times? Now, that's the title of my book, How to Read the Bible in Changing Times. And we're going to move really rapidly because of our time commitments. We've got about a half an hour to cover a lot of material. So if you want to go in more depth, you can pick up the book because I cover all of these topics in more depth in that. All right, let me start with four things the Bible is not. Four things that we often think the Bible is, but the Bible is not. The first one we were just talking about, and that is the Bible is not a list of commands to obey. Now, don't get me wrong. The Bible has lots of commands we are called to obey, and most Christians would recognize commands like this as something we as believers need to obey. Deuteronomy 6:5, the famous Shema, "Hear, O Israel, the word of the Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength." Absolutely, we obey that command. But there are other commands that we recognize we don't have to obey. Leviticus 19:19, do not wear clothing woven of two kinds of material. Now again, we might say, well, that's part of the old covenant, but then we turn to the new covenant, and there are many commands in the new covenant that we don't obey either, that most people would not obey. Greet one another with a kiss of love. Most of us don't feel like that's necessary, right? We would maybe show affection in other ways, but we don't obey that command directly. So the Bible is not a list of commands to obey. We're going to talk about how we discern what commands to obey, what they reflect, those commands that reflect the heart of God we are to obey. Okay, here's a second thing the Bible is not. The Bible is not a list of promises to claim, a list of promises to claim. Now, are there promises in the Bible? Absolutely, there are promises. But we have to recognize those promises are given in a particular cultural context. Okay, I'm going to pick on one of the most famous ones, so you're going to get real angry at me at this point, right? Well, first of all, I don't know if you You've ever sang the song in Sunday school? Every promise in the book is mine, every chapter, every verse, every line. How many of you know that song? This is happening. Every class, it's fewer and fewer, right? This is one of the great songs of Sunday school. Every promise in the book is mine. Is every promise in the book mine? Right? Now, of course, there's other problems in the statement. Every chapter, how many chapters are in the original Bible? None, right? They didn't have any chapters. They didn't have any verse. So every line, they do have lines. But is every promise in the book mine? Well, here's probably the most famous promise of all. For I know the plans I have for you, Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future, right? Great life verse for many people. That's a promise we can claim, right? You're afraid of me now, aren't you? Yeah. You know, if you read a little further, here's another promise in Jeremiah 29, the same chapter. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I will send the sword, famine, and plague against them. I will make them like figs that are so bad they cannot be eaten. I will pursue them with the sword, famine, and plague, and will make them abhorrent to all the kingdoms of the earth, a curse and an object of horror, of scorn, and reproach among all the nations where I drive them. Anyone want to claim that as your life verse? You know? Generally, we claim Jeremiah 29:11, but you see, Jeremiah 29:11 is given to one cultural context, one group. These are the Jews in Babylonian exile. The passage that follows is given to those Jews who are still in Judea at the time. Each of those promises has a context and an object. You have to discern who those people are who are receiving that promise. Not every promise is for you. We like to claim this one, that the Lord will grant you abundant prosperity. Amen. Poverty will come on you like a bandit, and scarcity like an armed man. We won't claim that one. Right? Remember Hezekiah, King Hezekiah. This is what the Lord says. Put your house in order because you're going to die. You will not recover. There's a promise. There's a statement. You are going to die. Did he die? Eventually, right? But no, he prayed, right? He prayed that God would lengthen his life. And sure enough, God responded. Many promises are contingent on the response of the individual. The Lord came to Isaiah, go and tell Hezekiah, this is what the Lord, the God of your father David, says. I've heard your prayers and seen your tears. I will add 15 years to your life. Promises are given in specific context. We've got to understand that context before we can just claim that promise for ourselves. So the Bible is not a bunch of commands to obey. It's not a bunch of promises to claim. Here's the third thing. The Bible is not a magic answer book. Now we know this, but we still use it this way frequently, I think. It's like the story of the young soldier in boot camp who was just struggling under the rigors of boot camp, and he didn't know what to do. And so he opened his Bible, his Gideon Bible he found, and opened it to Genesis 12:1, where it says, get ye out of this country. So he went AWOL, right? He looked for an answer, like a Ouija board, where you're looking for an answer. And he opened the Bible and he found a spot. The Bible is not a quick answer book. It's not a magic answer book. It will not tell you who to marry. You know, you open your Bible, Jezebel, that's a bad choice, right? Right? It will not tell you what career to pursue. Now, we laugh, but we have a tendency still to do this. In fact, when I'm teaching hermeneutics, this is one of the most controversial topics we talk about. Let me illustrate this for you. Years ago, I was teaching a class at a church with two other teachers. We were going through a particular book. It's the book Experiencing God by Blackaby. Now, it's a great book in many ways. It basically says God is at work in the world, and we need to get on board with what God is doing. It's a great book. But there's a chapter in that book on reading the Bible. And I thought, this is great, because this is going to give us the thesis that the Bible tells us what God is doing in the world, and we need to get on board. But instead, as I read that chapter, I realized it was mostly magic answer book answers to how we read the Bible. In that particular chapter. And let me give you one story. The story of a man and his wife, and he was a dentist, and they were working in a particular town, but he began to feel called to ministry. Got a call to another town. A church actually called him to minister. The woman was not feeling like they should go. She was not feeling this was God's word until she's reading her Bible and she came to this passage. She came to Luke chapter 4, verse 43. But he said, I must proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God to other towns also, because that is why I was sent. She said, there's a message from God for me right there. We are to move to another town. So this was a message from God to move to another town. Does God speak in this way? That's a tough question, isn't it? Does God speak through random verses taken out of context? When I put it that way, we might say no, but that's not what this passage meant. Was this a call to get up and move to another town to pick up a ministry there? What if she had read Isaiah 33:20, look upon Zion, a tent that will not be moved. You're going to stay in the same place. You're not going to be moved, right? So here's the question. Does God speak through random verses taken out of context? Have you ever heard God speak through just, you've opened your Bibles and you read a verse and God in some way speaks to you through that verse. And yet that verse isn't what the text meant in its particular context. Suppose you're deciding what college to attend, whether it's going to be an East Coast college or a West Coast college, maybe Stanford or Princeton, right? Or maybe Point Loma or Gordon, right? You're trying to decide. So you're reading in the text and you read it here. They raise their voices, they shout for joy. From the West, they acclaim the Lord's majesty. Stanford, right? Or Point Loma in that case. Or the School of Ministry. I should have said that, shouldn't I? Yeah, the School of Ministry, that's the West Coast one, right? But what if you had just kept going? Therefore, in the East, give glory to God, to the Lord. Exalt the name of the Lord, the God of Israel, and the islands of the sea. The islands, now you got to go to Hawaii. Well, that's really good. Now, we laugh at these kinds of ideas, but in fact, we do it. In fact, I have a family story I talk about in the book. My father was a pastor in Huntsville, Alabama for years. He got a call to come to California to be pastor of Emmanuel Faith Community Church in Escondido, California. He was agonizing over that decision. And he actually went away on a spiritual retreat to try to make a decision. And he was praying about it and fasting about it. And he came to this particular verse. He's reading through Isaiah, King James Version, because that's what he was using at the time. Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Now he's in Alabama, right? That's the thing God has him in now. God says, I will do a new thing. So he's going to do something new in your life. Not only is he going to do something new, it's going to be in a desert area, Southern California, right? Well, this became part of our family lore. This was part of the decision to move from Alabama to California. In fact, he wrote it in a book he wrote. He gave this as an illustration of how God led him. Now, I have to stop and think, is that an accurate reading of God's word, God's will? Now, this is where we sort of get into big discussions, which we won't do right now. But does God speak? In context, this passage is about the eschatological future, God's restoration of all things, God's restoration of all creation. Does it mean you should move from one job to another? Is God about to do something new in your life whenever you read this verse, for example? Does it mean you should move to a desert region? Right? This is a challenge, isn't it? Does God speak to us through random verses taken out of context? Let me give you a possible answer. God can speak to you in any way he wants. God can speak to you through a friend. God can speak to you through a billboard on the side of the road, I think, right? He can speak to you. He can communicate any way he chooses to. But don't give the Bible any higher authority for that kind of communication than a billboard on the side of the road, because it violates the most fundamental principle of Bible study, which is what? Reading the Bible in context, right? If that's not what it meant, then it can't mean that. Both John and Wayne said that in their messages today. A text cannot mean what it never meant. If it didn't mean that in the past, then it can't mean that to us today as well. So there's a challenging topic. Is the Bible a magic answer book? I would argue it is not. We need to understand it in context. Here's the fourth one before we go into some positive response here. The Bible is not a handbook on Christian ethics. Not a handbook on Christian ethics. Does the Bible give the last word on every ethical issue? Every moral issue? Now, this is a challenging one as well, right? Does the Bible give the last word? Does it give the absolute ethic, for example, on slavery? Does it give the absolute or the last word on marriage, on slavery? Your male and female slaves are to come from the nations around you, From them you may buy slaves. Israel couldn't buy slaves within Israel, other Jews, but they could buy them on the in the surrounding nations. Does that mean we can buy slaves from Canada, but not from the U.S.? Obviously not. That's not the absolute word on slavery. Here's Titus 2:9, New Covenant. Teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them, not to talk back to them. Now, we wish Paul had said something like, free your slaves, this is a horrible evil. But in his cultural context, that would have been impossible for him to do. So do we get yet an absolute ethic in even the New Testament? Or is the New Testament pointing into a particular direction that we should go? Here's a challenging question. On polygamy, if a man has two wives, Deuteronomy 21:15, if a man has two wives, a man should not have two wives. You know, that's what you expect it to say. But instead, if it happens, then he ought to act in this particular way. You see, the Bible is speaking into, just as John was telling, speaking into a particular cultural context. We have to recognize that first of all before we draw principles and apply them to ourselves. There's also a bunch of issues the Bible does not address. Challenging new ethical issues that the Bible says nothing about. Abortion, euthanasia, drug abuse, gambling, child abuse, spousal abuse, stem cell research, war and pacifism, genetic engineering, birth control, pornography, premarital sex. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying the Bible doesn't speak into these issues. I'm saying the Bible doesn't directly address them. So the question is, how do we read Scripture to make good decisions, good and godly decisions on issues like this? Those are four things the Bible is not. Here are three things the Bible is. Let's turn positive here. The Bible is God's Word. That's where we started. His message to us. The Bible is God's Word, His message to us. What do we mean when we say the Bible is God's Word? Obviously, there's lots of words. It's not a single word. The word word there means message. God has revealed Himself to us through His Word. That's where we start. We started with 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture is God-breathed. All Scripture is useful. But the challenge then becomes how He communicates and how we respond. So secondly, most importantly, the Bible is not just God's Word. The Bible is also human words delivered through human agents in diverse circumstances. And this is what we've been talking about all morning. This is all about context. Why do we need hermeneutics? Why do we need biblical interpretation? If the Bible is not given in a cultural context, if God just spoke to us, whenever He wanted us to do something, if He just spoke to us directly, then we just do what He says to do. But that's not the way He revealed Himself. He revealed Himself in time and place and in culture. We've got to understand those cultures and contexts. The Bible documents were written in a historical, cultural, and social, political world far removed from our own. To understand them, we have to enter that world. Now, there's lots of analogies for this. Probably the most famous one, the one that's really helpful for me, is the hermeneutical bridge. We've talked a little bit about that in various contexts this morning. The hermeneutical bridge, the distance between us in our world, whatever world that is, and whatever context around the world that is, and the biblical world. And there is a chasm between us and them, a chasm of time, a chasm of place, a chasm of culture, a chasm of language. And so what is our first task? We hear the word exegesis all the time, right? Exegesis is crossing back. Exegesis is entering into the world of the text. And that's what John especially was focusing on. We got to enter the world of the text. What was the cosmology? What was the worldview in which the text was given? We've got to first understand that before we can apply it to our lives. Once we've discerned what the message was to them in their cultural context, that's only half the task. The harder task in many ways is then saying, okay, now how would God want us to live based on what He said to them in their time, in their place, in their context? We often call that contextualization. Contextualization is just application, but we use that more technical term because application can be bad application, right? We can misapply a text. Contextualization is taking that passage in one context, introducing it accurately and correctly into another context. So the bridge is moving backwards through exegesis and then across through exegesis and then back to contextualization. We talk about the diversity of Scripture. Scripture is diverse in so many different ways. Diversity of authors, diversities of languages, diversities of time and place, diversity of purposes, diversities of literary genre. Genre is one of the most foundational, one of the ones that's often traditionally been ignored. We sometimes have taught, if you pick up a book on Bible study methods, it'll say, what are the main steps of Bible study methods? In observation, interpretation, application. Have you ever heard that? Observation, interpretation, application. Those are the steps. But that those three steps, well, first of all, those three steps are wrong. See if I can get a little response here. How many of you have ever observed something without interpreting it? Can you observe anything without interpreting it? Whenever you observe anything, what is your mind doing? It's interpreting it. It's discerning what it is. So really, those are one step. And it's called exegesis, okay? Observation, interpretation is really exegesis. And then application then is contextualization. But the key is what those three steps leave out is genre. Different literary forms. Different literary forms communicate truth in different ways. And so a key part of exegesis is identifying the genre. Let me just illustrate this a little bit. Here's Revelation 13:1. The dragon stood on the shore of the sea, and I saw a beast coming out of the sea. He had 10 horns and 7 heads, with 10 crowns on his horns, and on each head a blasphemous name. That is really bizarre, right? Is this a human being coming out of the sea? No, it's a beast, right? Now, it's interesting. Some people say we interpret the Bible literally. We interpret the Bible literally, but then they'll say, but the beast is the Antichrist. And the Antichrist is Nikolai Carpathia or something. What's that? Yeah. He's this good-looking guy, you know? No, he's not. He's a beast. He's an animal, right? He's got 10 crowns on his horns. He's got 7 heads. That's what the Antichrist is going to look like, literally. The point is, no one takes the book of Revelation literally. We take it in its original context, in its particular genre. What's the genre of Revelation? What do we call it? Apocalyptic literature, right? Apocalyptic literature, literary form common in the first century, in first century Judaism, but not very common here. Closest to fantasy, maybe, in our cultural context. Trying to understand what those symbols mean is crucial, right? Here's another example of a literary genre. You'll go out in joy, be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills will burst into song before you. The trees of the field will clap their hands. It's like a Disney movie, right? I'm just waiting to see the trees clap. You can kind of see the little mountains, their little mouths go, well, you know, the little mountains singing, right? What's the genre? Well, it's prophecy. It's prophecy portraying the renewal of creation in poetic terms. How does poetry work? We've got to understand genre in order to understand God's word. Here's another example. Proverbs, proverbial genre. Do not answer a fool according to his folly, or you will be like him yourself. Should you answer a fool? You are afraid of me, aren't you? Should you answer? It's right there. It's God's word. It says, do not answer a fool according to his folly. Do not answer a fool. But then you go to the very next verse. The very next verse. Answer a fool according to his folly, or he will be wise in his own eyes. Right? So here's two proverbs side by side that say the opposite things. Because proverbs are not absolute truths. Proverbs are general truths that apply to specific situations, teaching us how to live good and godly lives. I just came across this one here the other day. Ecclesiastes 10:19. A feast is made for laughter. Wine makes life merry. And money is the answer for everything. I think I found a new life verse, right? Money is the answer for everything. But then you realize, what's this genre? That's Ecclesiastes. That's human wisdom that ends in futility, right? So you've got to understand the genre there. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. That's a great verse. There's a great life verse right there. Whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. But what's the genre? Careful here. What's the genre? Letter! Thank you. A lot of Bible scholars here. It's a letter. 1 Corinthians is a letter, right? Okay, so a letter has a specific occasion and purpose. Now, we recognize, of course, that that's a statement for all time. But elsewhere in the letter, what do you read? Every woman who has her head uncovered while praying or prophesying disgraces her head. Now be careful, because you sometimes we say something like, Paul tells us that whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. We say, great, Paul tells us to do everything for the glory of God. But then to say, Paul tells us that every woman who has her head covered disgraces her head, is that true? Does Paul tell us that? Who did Paul tell that to? The Corinthians. We've got to think in terms of genre, you see. That was written to them. Both of these verses were written to the Corinthians. One of them has a direct application to us. One of them probably only applies in the level of principle. So you can see it's so crucial, it's so critical to identify the genre. We should almost, I'll use that caveat, we should almost never say Paul tells us or even Jesus tells us. We should say, what is he, who is he talking to, and then how does that apply to us in our particular context? The dilemma is what we've already seen. The Bible was not written to you, which is meant to shock our students, right? The Bible's not written to you. Here's a Peanuts cartoon that illustrates this. I've been using this one for years. Charlie Brown says to Linus, where have you been? Linus says, church school. We've been studying the letters of the Apostle Paul. Charlie Brown responds, that should be interesting. Linus says, it is, although I must admit it makes me feel a little guilty. I always feel like I'm reading someone else's mail. Right? When you read a letter, what are you doing? You're reading someone else's mail. Now, is that mail for you? It's absolutely for you, but it's not to you. And that's what's crucial. Here's the solution. The Bible's not written to you, but it was written for you. And everything we're doing today is talking about moving from the two to the four. Right? That's what Bible reading is all about. That's what applying Scripture is all about, moving from the two to the four. So the Bible is God's word, his message to us. The Bible is also human words given in particular times and place. In order to apply it to our lives, we have to understand that time and that place. Here's the third key point related to what the Bible is, which is equally crucial. The Bible is the story. It's the meta-narrative. It's the drama of God's dealing with human beings, what we call the divine drama of redemption. From beginning to end, it's one story. It tells how God, the one creator God, created the universe, created human beings as the pinnacle of his creation, but that human beings turned against him and rejected him and entered into a fallen state, and all of creation entered a fallen state. And the whole rest of the Bible, from Genesis 3 onward, is God's purpose and plan to bring us back into right relationship with him. Understanding that story is crucial. Understanding the story. The story teaches us who God is. Okay, the meta-narrative, the story of Scripture teaches us who God is. It teaches us who we are in relationship to him, created in his image, fallen, yet valuable in his eyes. It teaches us what his purpose for the world is. His purpose is to bring us back into a right relationship with him, to redeem us as children of God once again. The story teaches us then, in light of this purpose, how we ought to live in relationship to him and to others. You see, we're taking a step back. We're not saying, okay, this command I'm going to obey because it's a command of Scripture. We're taking back and saying, what does this command teach us about the nature of God? What does it teach us about our relationship to him? What does it teach us about the way we should walk with him? So here's what we must do. We must immerse ourselves in God's story. First of all, we've got to understand the story from beginning to end. How does it begin? What went wrong? What is God's purpose and plan for redemption? What role do we play in the story? Immerse ourselves in the story. And from that story, here's what every passage of Scripture teaches us. Every passage of Scripture teaches us who God is. It teaches us who we are in relationship to him. It teaches us his purpose and plan in the world. So we can learn God's values and God's purposes. And then we make decisions in line with his character, in line with his values, in line with his purposes. Now in the book, I call this a heart of God hermeneutic. It's a heart of God hermeneutic. Because what are we seeking in Scripture? We're seeking to understand who God is. We're seeking to understand his relationship to us, who we are in relationship to him. We're seeking to understand his purpose and plans. We're seeking to think his thoughts after him so that we can discern God's desires in this world. The only way we can do that is by immersing ourselves in the Word of God from beginning to end, not just doing proof texting, pulling out individual verses, but immersing ourselves in God's Word. Let me give you four key questions then to ask of any text of Scripture. Whatever the genre, whatever the text, whatever the context, whatever the culture, here are four key questions to ask of any text of Scripture. First of all, first question is, where is this passage in the greater story? Where is this passage in this greater story? You've got to understand the story and identify where you are when this text is given. Let me give you an example. Do not plant your field with two kinds of... Did I get the first one? Yeah. Do not plant your field with two kinds of seed. Do not wear clothing woven of two kinds of material. Where are you in that story, in the story at this point? We're under the old covenant, right? And this is clearly symbolic in some way related to purity. So God is calling his people to be pure in that cultural context. This is what you are to offer on the altar regularly each day, 2 lambs a year old. Where are you in the story? Again, you're in the old covenant, right? What does that teach us about the nature of God? It's going to teach us something about the nature of God. In the old covenant, they were called to give animal sacrifices. Are we called to give animal sacrifices? Well, here's part of the new covenant. Where are we in the story here? We're in the new covenant. Hebrews chapter 9, verses 11 and 12. When Christ came as high priest, he did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood. And we see when we get to that point in the story, we see that these sacrifices are images and symbols pointing forward to the ultimate sacrifice in Christ. But to understand that, you've got to identify where you are in the story at any particular point where you're reading. So that's key. Identify where you are in the story. Even in the New Covenant, you're in the first century church. You're not in the 21st century church necessarily. So how would God have us to live in this cultural context? Here's the second question to ask. What is the author's purpose in its original context? Let me give you a little bit of a controversial statement. The purpose of a command is more important than the command itself in Scripture. Let me illustrate this for you. Suppose my son's home from college, and I ask him, I say, here's $10. I want you to go wash the car. Go run down to the automatic car wash and take it through the automatic car wash. He comes back an hour later. He gives me my $10 back. And he says, I decided to wash it myself. I also detailed it and vacuumed it. And in my dreams, he would do that. And so what do I do? At that point, I say, you disobeyed me. Do I get angry at him? Did he fulfill my command? Did he obey my command directly? No, he didn't. I told him to take it through the automatic car wash. Did he obey the purpose of my command? Did he fulfill the purpose of my command? He went above and beyond it, right? So the purpose of a command is more important than the command itself. So let me look at these. What's the original purpose of this command? Greet one another with a kiss. Did Paul want lots of kissing to go on in the church? It's really important that everybody kisses. Everybody's got to kiss. That's called legalism, right? Everybody's got to kiss. No, what does he want? What did a kiss symbolize? Who kissed each other? Family members kissed each other. Right? This is a sign of affection, family affection. The church is to treat each other as family. We're to show affection to one another. We're to care for each other as family. That's the purpose of the command. No longer drink water exclusively, but use a little wine for the sake of your stomach. Is the purpose of the command to make sure everybody drinks wine? No, the purpose of the command in this context is because Timothy is sickly and he's being too legalistic. He's being too ascetic. He's denying himself too much. Paul says, relax. It's okay to take some medicine. It's okay to take care of yourself, not to be so legalistic. Here's a negative example. Every woman who has her head uncovered while praying or prophesying disgraces her head. By negative, I say, if you get a commentary, a good commentary on 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and read about this passage, you'll see we're all kind of baffled by this passage. There's like 10 different issues in this passage that exegetes just go, we don't really know what was going on in the first century. It's really hard to identify the very specific purpose of this command. And if we can't discern the purpose, then its application, we need to be very, very careful not to impose a particular application on the text. Here's the point. Proper application begins with sound exegesis. I'm going to skip ahead here. Oops, I didn't do that. You probably want to see the cartoons, don't you? Here's the third key question. What do we learn here about the nature and purpose of God? Every passage, no matter what the genre, teaches us about God's nature and purpose. And that's crucial. Right? We might say this genre is bizarre. It's not the kind of genre we're used to reading about, and yet it teaches us something about God's nature, about his purpose. So what does this teach us about his nature and purpose? This is what you're to offer on the altar regularly each day, 2 lambs a year old. What do we learn about God's nature from his command to make animal sacrifices? We learn that he's a righteous and just God, and that he's a perfect God, and sin has consequences. So even though we don't apply that command directly, we learn something about God's nature and purpose. Do not plant your field with two kinds of seed. Do not wear clothing made of two kinds of material. Again, we're not quite positive as to what specifically, but almost certainly passages like this are meant to teach the purity of God, the righteousness of God, the perfection of God. Greet one another with a kiss of love. What does this teach us about the nature of God? That God is our loving Father, and He wants us to live as family with one another. Go sell everything you have and give to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. What does this teach us? Now we'll say, you know, we'll come to this passage and we go, oh, he told this to the rich young ruler. He didn't tell us. And then we go, whew, right? But what does this passage teach us about the nature and purpose of God? What does God demand from us? Everything. Our very lives, right? For this individual, it was his riches that were keeping him from that right relationship with God. What is keeping us from that relationship with God? 1 Corinthians 7:27, are you married? Do not seek a divorce. Are you unmarried? Do not look for a wife. Is this a command you should never look for a wife or a husband? What does this teach us about the nature and purpose of God? Ultimately, where is our allegiance? Ultimately, it's God alone. Okay, here's our fourth question. Who ought we to be then? Based on what we know about God, based on what we know about His purpose and plan, who ought we to be and what ought we to do as those seeking to reflect the nature and purpose of God? You see, once we've discerned the heart of God, then we learn to make good and godly decisions based on that heart of God. I'm going to ask how we're doing with time. I know I started a little bit late. Do we need to wrap it up at this point? We're good? Can I have five more? Five more minutes? Okay. Five more minutes. Okay, we're going to go five more minutes. I just want to give you some principles, okay? Some criteria for cultural analysis. These things have been rather general principles. Four questions to ask of any text. But what about when you come to a passage and you go, does this apply today or is this culturally for that particular context? Now, in the book, I give you eight principles. I'm not going to give you those. We're not going to walk through those eight in 5 minutes. But I do want to briefly mention three key principles. Three key criteria for cultural analysis. And we've covered them briefly already. Here's the first one, the criterion of purpose. Here's the point. The purpose or rationale behind a command determines its application. This is so crucial. We've got to seek to determine what's the purpose behind the command. We've already talked a little bit about that. The purpose or rationale behind a command determines its application. The holy kiss. What's the purpose or rationale behind kissing one another in Paul's context? It's family affection. It's caring for one another. It's treating each other like family. The head covering, what's the purpose of that in its cultural context? We don't know, right? At least I don't know. I struggle with that passage, so we need to be careful how we apply it. So the criterion of purpose is that the purpose of the command determines its application. Here's a second criterion, the criterion of cultural correspondence. The criterion of cultural correspondence. And we all do this implicitly, I know, as we read, but we need to ask, how similar is this situation culturally to our situation today? The principle is that the closer the cultural or historical context to our own, the more likely we can apply the command directly. The closer it is to our own cultural context, the more likely we can apply directly. Now, let me illustrate this for you. I'll leave that up because I know you're trying to copy it down. But Ephesians 5:18, do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Okay, in Ephesians chapter 5, Paul says, don't get drunk with wine. Now we have to ask, how similar and parallel is drunkenness today as it was in the first century? Is it basically the same issue? Pretty much the same issue, right? It caused social problems, it caused family problems, caused relationship problems, caused personal health problems. Pretty much alcohol does the same thing, both positively, we could say, and negatively, as it did in the first century. Drunkenness has the same basic social impact in the first century as it did. So there's direct cultural context. So if there's direct cultural context, we know, well, this passage almost certainly applies today. That's the criterion of cultural context. So there's that passage, Ephesians 5:18. Here's one, 1 Timothy 2:9. I also want women to dress modestly, not with braided hair or gold or pearls or expensive clothes. Okay. Now we look at that, and again, in some contexts we say, well, women can't wear gold. No gold jewelry, right? Because it's explicitly commanded in Scripture not to wear, not braided hair. That's kind of the country look, you know? Not braided hair. Well, what is going on here? Is there cultural correspondence? Well, if you see these statues of Roman women, they've got these huge coiffers, is that what you call them? Coiffer, they've got these huge hairdos, and they would be jeweled. They put their valuable jewels and things in it, and it was a way to show off your wealth. It was ostentatious, showing off your wealth. Is that happening today? Well, you can show off your wealth in a variety of ways, but it's not completely overruling the idea of braided hair or gold or pearls. So look, you've got the general principle, first of all. I want women to dress modestly, men and women to dress modestly. Then the specific cultural application, not with braided hair or gold and pearls in that particular cultural context. So that's cultural correspondence. John 13, when he'd finished washing their feet, now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. Foot washing. Right? What's the cultural context? Well, roads were dusty. People walked in sandals. When they arrived in the home, to have your feet washed was common culturally, a sign of hospitality. Today, it's not generally a sign of hospitality. When I arrive at someone's house to have dinner with them, they don't usually say, okay, shoes off, we're going to wash your feet. If they do, I'm petrified, especially if I went running or something before I, you know, it's usually the person who has their foot washed who's more embarrassed. So there's not a lot of cultural context there or cultural correspondence there. Do not cut your bodies for the dead or tattoo marks on yourselves. Are tattoos the same in that cultural context, that this Old Testament context? What do those tattoos indicate? That's what we've got to discern. That's what we've got to determine what they indicate. Almost certainly there's something different. This is some kind of religious thing, almost certainly. Idolatry there. Unless, of course, it's my daughter who wants to get the tattoo. In which case, I pull out Leviticus 19:28. Absolutely not. God forbids you to have the tattoo. But then she came home with a nose ring, and I couldn't argue against it. Because in Genesis 24:22, then at last, when the camels had finished drinking, he took out a gold ring for her nose and two large gold bracelets for her wrists. This is Abraham. This is Abraham's servant with reference to finding a wife for Isaac, finding Rebekah there. Okay, finally, let me just give this to you. The third criterion, ethical imperatives that remain consistent throughout the Bible likely reflect God's universal will, right? If things are not changing in the various biblical cultures, if they're staying the same throughout the biblical cultures, then almost certainly they're consistent for today. Let me just give you some examples of this. Adultery. Is adultery always wrong? Right, you don't hide. Sometimes it's okay, sometimes no, it's always wrong. Adultery, murder, always wrong. Stealing, always wrong. Exploitation of the poor, always wrong. Whenever you find these things in Scripture, whether it's Old Testament, whether it's New Testament, it's always wrong. On the other hand, eating shellfish. Jesus declares all foods clean in Mark chapter 3, right? Drinking alcohol. No, there's positive and negative statements about alcohol. Eating food sacrificed to idols. Paul says sometimes it's okay, sometimes it's not. So if you don't have something that's consistent across Scripture, then almost certainly it's not a universal command. Now this gets us to one of the things that in the description of this session it mentioned, and I'm just going to mention it briefly because I've got to close it up here, but the issue of same-sex relationships. Scripture consistently identifies homosexual behavior, we're talking about behavior here, as contrary to God's will for human sexuality. Consistently, from the Old Testament through the New Testament, that would point us in the direction that this is something related to human nature, human sexuality in general. On the other hand, the issue, I would argue, of women's roles is much more open. You've got a lot of more diversity in terms of the leadership roles of women. Paul can say, I do not permit a woman to teach or assume authority over man, 1 Timothy 2. But then in Galatians 3, he says, there's neither Jew nor Greek, neither slave nor free, neither male nor female. Now, I know we can do all kinds of exegesis on those passages. Maybe I should have just ended just before this, before we introduce this. But I read through Scripture, and I see lots of exceptions. You've got exceptions like Deborah. You've got exceptions like Miriam. You've got exceptions like Priscilla. Are they exceptions or not? We can battle. We can argue over that. But there's no doubt that this is an issue that is not nearly as clear-cut as the other one. So that's the criterion of canonical consistency across Scripture. Okay, I'm going to stop there. The rest of the criterion you can check out in the book if you want to. The issue of contextualization means how do we hear God speak to us today? God's word is his self-revelation, absolutely his self-revelation. What do we learn about God? We learn about who he is, who we are in relationship to him, and then we can discern the heart of God so that we can learn to make good and godly decisions based on his nature, based on his purpose.